Harper Audio presents Dirty Blonde by Lisa Scottoline, narrated by Barbara Rosenblat. Prologue. Cate Fante was the guest of honor at this celebration, which was drawing to a liquefied close. She raised a final snifter of cognac, joining the judges toasting her appointment to the district court. Tomorrow would be a slow day on the bench. The wheels of justice weren't lubricated by Remy Martin. To Judge Cate Fante, our new colleague, Chief Judge Sherman shouted, and the judges clinked glasses with a costly chime. Wrinkled cheeks draped their tipsy smiles, and their bifocals reflected the flickering candlelight. Their average age was 62, and an appointment to the federal bench was for life. At 39, Cate felt like she was joining the world's most exclusive retirement village. Speech! Speech! The judges called out, their encouragement echoing in the private room. Golden light glowed from brass sconces, and coffee cooled next to scalloped half-moons of creme brulee and bread pudding veined with cinnamon. Speech, Judge Fante! Order in the court, you crazy kids! Cate called back, rising with her glass and only apparent bravado. She managed a smile that masked her panic about what to say. She couldn't tell the truth, namely that she was secretly intimidated by a job described in the Constitution of the United States, or that she only looked the part, in a Chanel suit of butterscotch tweed, donned like overpriced armor. Keep it short, Cate. Judge William Sasso formed a megaphone with his hands. It's past my bedtime. Judge Gloria Sullivan chuckled. Give her a break, Bill. We listen to you, and God knows what a trial that can be. No, he's right. Cate gathered her nerve. Thank you for this lovely dinner, everyone. You said a lot of nice things about me tonight, and I just want you to know, I deserve every single word.
At last, an honest judge.
Chief Judge Sherman burst into laughter, as did the others. The young waiter smiled, hovering by the wall. The judges clapped, shouting,
Way to go! Well done!
Thank you and good night. Cate mock-bowed and caught the waiter's eye, then looked away. She accepted the congratulations and goodbyes as the judges rose to leave, collecting their briefcases and bags. She grabbed her purse, and they all walked to the door, filing out of the Four Seasons restaurant. On the way out, Cate felt a soft touch on her arm and turned to see Chief Judge Sherman, tall and stooped at her shoulder, his sterling silver hair slightly frizzy.
Don't look so happy, kiddo. You're taking a major pay cut.
Cate laughed. Chief, you give fixed income a good name. Chief Judge Sherman laughed, as did Judge Jonathan Meriden, who fell into stride. Meriden was 50-something, conventionally handsome, with sandy hair going to gray, and a fit, if short, stature. Cate had a legal history with Meriden. When they were both in practice, he'd tried a securities case against her, and ended up losing the jury verdict and the client. Tonight, he'd acted as if all was forgotten. So, he'd sucked it up, or warmed to her, with Glenn Levitt's help. They walked out of the lobby into the humid summer night, and Cate played the good hostess, waiting until everyone had dispersed to grab the last cab. Inside, she leaned against the black vinyl as the cab lurched into light traffic. Its tires rumbled on the gritty streets, wet from an earlier thunderstorm. The air conditioning blew only faintly, and Cate eyed the rain-slick buildings like a stranger to the city. She'd lived in Philadelphia since law school, but her heart wasn't in the city. She'd grown up in the mountains, in a small town erased from the map. Cate still felt a twinge at the thought, even though she knew she wasn't supposed to care about her hometown anymore. She was pretty sure the official cutoff was fourth grade. Cate's head began to ache. Today she'd presided over opening arguments in her first major trial, a construction contract case with damages of $50 million. Fleets of pricey lawyers from New York had filed special appearances, and the witness lists contained more PhDs than most colleges. It was a bench trial, with no jury to make the decision, but at least it was a civil case. Cate already sentenced four men to federal prison, which was four too many. The cab was stifling, and Cate lowered the window. A breeze blew in, too sticky to offer any relief, and she unbuttoned the top of her silk blouse. She felt the weight of her pearls like a noose. The night sky was black and starless, and the full moon a spotlight. She leaned back against the seat, but her chignon got in the way, so she loosened it with her fingers. She looked idly out the window. Couples walked together, their arms wrapped around each other, their hips bumping. A handsome man in a white Oxford shirt dashed across the street, his tie flying. The cab turned onto one of the skinny back streets that scored Center City, no more than an alley with rusted blue dumpsters lining the curb. Cate caught a whiff of the rotting smell. "The scenic route, huh?" "It's faster than south," the driver said, and the cab slowed to a stop sign, waiting for someone to cross the street. Cate eyed a run-down tavern on the corner. Dell and Roy's flickered a failing neon sign, and graffiti blanketed its brick. Its side window was covered with plywood, though an amber glow emanated from yellow plexiglass in the front door, which was the only indication the bar wasn't abandoned. "It's Miller time," Cate thought. The line from an old TV commercial. Her mother used to drink Miller. The champagne of bottled beer. "I'll get out here," she said suddenly, digging in her purse for the fare.
"Here."
The driver twisted around on his side of the smudged plastic divider.
"Lady, this ain't the best block. I thought we were going to Society Hill."
"Change of plans." Cate slid a 20 from her wallet and handed it to him. 10 minutes later, she was perched on a wobbly bar stool behind a glass of Miller. Lipstick stained the rim of her glass, a sticky red kiss slashed with lines, like vanity's own fingerprint. It wasn't her color, but she drank anyway. The bar reeked of stale draft and Marlboros, and dusty liquor bottles cluttered its back underneath a cardboard cutout of Donovan McNabb, set askew. The bar area doubled as a hallway to a closed dining room, its darkened doorway marked by an old-fashioned sign that read, "Ladies' Entrance." Cate looked away. The bar was half empty, and a man with dark hair hunched over a beer 2 seats from her, smoking a cigarette. He wore a white T-shirt that said C&C Towing, stretching in block letters across a muscular back. 3 men sat beyond him, silently watching the baseball game, the Phillies playing San Francisco, on a TV mounted above the bar. They watched with their heads tilted back, their bald spots an ellipsis. Cate crossed her legs, bare in her brown pumps, and took a sip of warm beer. She hated herself for being here, and at the same time wondered how long it would take. It wasn't that she wanted to get home to sleep. She could function on almost none, from a childhood interrupted by nighttime alarms. She'd be pulled from bed and dressed in a winter coat with an embroidered penguin, worn over a thin nightgown. The coat was turquoise, and the penguin of raised black fuzz, she remembered now, for some reason. She had loved that coat.
"Hey,"
said a voice beside her, and Cate looked over. It was the man in the T-shirt, with his beer and Marlboro. Up close, he had bloodshot blue eyes, heavy stubble, and hair that shone in greasy strands. He smiled drunkenly and asked,
"Are you beautiful?"
Cate turned to him and smiled. "Evidently beautiful." The man chuckled and set his beer on the bar, his cigarette trailing a snake of smoke.
"I think I know you're from somewhere," he said, putting his hand on Kate's bare knee. "What's your name again?"
"Karen," Cate told him, then moved his hand up onto her thigh. Feeling thrilled and miserable, both at once. Chapter 1. 6 months later, Cate sat in her high-backed chair atop the dais, waiting to start the day's session. The courtroom was packed, and she hid her anticipation behind a professional mask, which was turning out to be a job requirement. The jury trial had taken all last week, but today was the only day that counted, like the final 2 minutes in a basketball game. Sixers, Hornets, it was on the bar last night. Wonder who won. Cate shifted behind the slippery wall of stacked pleadings in front of her. She hadn't slept well last night and was relying on her concealer, but was otherwise in full costume. Synthetic black robes, dark blonde hair in a judicial chignon, a swipe of pink gloss on her lips, and neutral makeup on largish blue eyes. Finally, the courtroom deputy flashed Cate a wink. Showtime. Cate gestured to plaintiff's counsel. Mr. Temin, let's begin. I assume that plaintiff continues his testimony this morning?
Yes, Your Honor.
Nathan Temin was a roly-poly lawyer with the paunch of a much older man and a dark suit that begged to be ironed, worn with equally unruly black hair. Still, Cate knew better than to judge a trial lawyer by his cover. She had dressed down for court many times. Prada didn't win jury verdicts. Excellent, Cate nodded. Fire when ready.
Thank you, Your Honor.
Temin hustled to the podium with a big pen and a legal pad, then pressed down his suit with a pudgy hand. He greeted the jury and turned to his client, already rising from counsel table.
Mr. Mars, please take the stand.
Richard Mars walked to the witness stand and necks craned from the gallery. Reporters scribbled away, and sketch artists switched to their flesh-toned chalk. The Eastern District of Pennsylvania didn't allow cameras in the courtroom, for which Cate, thank God, and Chief Judge Sherman.
Good morning, Your Honor,
Mars said in his soft-spoken way, sitting down after he was sworn in. He was barely 30 years old, and his baby blue eyes showed litigation strain. He smiled tightly, his lips taut as a rubber band, and he ran a finger rake through muddy brown curls that sprouted from under a crocheted yarmulke. A dark suit jacket popped open over his white shirt, and his striped tie hung unevenly. Everybody knew that people looked like their dogs, but Cate thought they looked like their lawyers.
Good morning, Mr. Mars.
She smiled at Mars in a professional way, feeling subterranean sympathy for his position. He was claiming that a powerful TV producer had stolen his idea for a series about Philadelphia lawyers and developed it into the cable blockbuster, Attorneys at Law. In this battle between David and Goliath, Mars held the slingshot. At the lectern, Temin tugged the black bud of a microphone down to his height.
Now, Mr. Mars, you testified last week that you had two meetings with Mr. Simone leading up to the critical meeting. Please remind the jury of what took place at the first meeting on June 10th.
Objection, Your Honor, said George Hartford, defense counsel.
Hartford had gray eyes behind slightly tinted bifocals and was prematurely bald. He had to be about 50 and stood tall and fit in a slim Italian suit with a yellow silk tie.
Asked and answered. Plaintiff's counsel is wasting the jury's time.
Temin said, Your Honor, it's appropriate to review this proof because the weekend intervened.
Overruled.
Cate shot both lawyers her sternest look.
Let's not let the objections get out of hand today, boys. Play nice.
Thank you, Your Honor.
Temin nodded, but a cranky Hartford eased back in his chair next to his client, producer Art Simone. Even seated, Simone looked tall and trim in his prime at a prosperous 40-something. His reddish hair had been shorn fashionably close to his scalp, and his tortoiseshell glasses paired with a caramel-colored silk tie and tan houndstooth suit. If Mars and Temin were the mutts in this dogfight, Simone and Hartford were purebred Afghans.
Mr. Mars, Temin began again, tell us briefly what happened at the June meeting with Mr. Simone.
Well, my background is from the DA's office, handling cases concerning computer fraud and internet crime. I always liked computers.
Mars sounded almost apologetic.
But I wanted to be a writer, so I started writing a screenplay for a TV show about four lawyers and how they use computer skills to solve murders. I called it Hard Drive. It was my wife who said, why don't you do something about it?
Mars smiled at his wife in the front row of the gallery, a sweet-faced brunette wearing a long skirt and sensible shoes.
So I called Art, Mr. Simone, and told him what I was doing and asked if he would meet with me about it, and he agreed to fly out to Philly to take the meeting.
Mars turned to the jury in an earnest way.
That's what they call it in L.A., taking a meeting. When they say no, they call it taking a hard pass. A soft pass is a maybe.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.